Today we're going to be looking at a couple replays of the POVs of players who are the beneficiaries of one of the biggest, if not maybe the biggest change that RLCS has added to its rule set. Now, if you don't know what I'm talking about, since the start of RLCS, there has been an age minimum to play in the league. Lots of different leagues, not just esports leagues, have age minimums. And for this one, it was 15 years old. I can't tell you why 15 years old was originally the decided age, but even from a long time ago, it was clear that some players were good enough to play in the league despite the fact that they weren't 15 years old. And I think the first that is truly notable is Scrubkilla. Scrubkilla was a guy who was around in the 1v1 scene for a long time and had played the predecessor to Rocket League before Rocket League even came out. And everyone was waiting to see what he would do in the league. And I'm sure you can think of a couple other players who were also ready to play. In fact, tried to play when they were Scribbles' age, which is the POV we're watching right now, Scribbles on the Snowmen. And they ended up having to get banned and waiting an additional year. Guys like Zen, guys like Nupo, and I believe there are many, many more, but those are probably the ones you know the most. And now they can play in the league officially. They can play early before they're 15 years old. And when the change was announced, a lot of people were saying, you know, they weren't necessarily going to be teaming up with the youngsters from the various regions. For North America, it was clearly Scribbles that everyone was talking about this change affecting, how he was going to be able to get into the RLCS a little bit early. But was he going to get picked up by a good team? Is he truly ready? One thing that has been the case for all of the up-and-coming players in the past is that there's usually signs of them being good by 13, especially by 14, and then they get a long time to really be tested out by, you know, the pros in either six-mans or even just ranked lobbies, and before they get a good idea of whether or not they'll be ready. And then by the time they're 15, they sometimes even jump in to big teams right away. We know that was definitely the case with Daniel. But now, I think the way that these players are going to make names for themselves is going to be a little bit different. We always knew that was going to be the case. In fact, I had a tournament in the past that I'm not sure if I'll ever run again, which was specifically for players who were under 15 years old to play in 1v1 events and show off their high-level ability, especially because 1v1 events started to get officially sponsored, so they couldn't even play in those either. And those was called the next gen. And, you know, the big winners being Chronic, Rawas, and Daniel, guys who now pretty much run the league, if you ask me. They're all on top teams. So are these players that we're going to be checking out today going to be, you know, the Chronic, Rawas, and Daniels of the future? They just might be. But instead of having to make their names in 1v1 tournaments outside of the official league, now they're making top fours. They're making top fours. And this is maybe the first time this weekend that under 15-year-old players have made top four. I know it had to have happened in this season, and I can't think of any other regions. Might be a couple of the regions that could have done it, but I want to say it is the replays we're going to be covering today. So Scribbles, who is 14 years old, the answer is that will the top teams test out, you know, 13 and 14-year-olds? Maybe not, but you know who will? Other young players. In this case, Frosty and Reveal, both 16 years old. Frosty, for a moment, was actually going to get, you know, put onto a big-name roster with NRG before whatever happened that resulted in Frosty no longer playing with them. But now Frosty is on the better end of that, as Scribbles makes a great recovery save as he plays alongside a couple other young buddies, and they made their way into the first top four for them this last regional. And this is one of their biggest matchups. We are watching Game 5 against Gen G. You know, NA has proven to be a two-team region, really, with G2 and Gen G, although signs this weekend maybe say SSG could be the third, or some people are willing to entertain the idea of Snowmen. I think Snowmen need to get another good result to really know for sure. There's no question that these are top players that people should be looking out for, but are they a clear, you know, international competition type major team? Are we going to see Snowmen, SSG, Gen G, and G2 at the major? I think it might be one of the most fun options, but it's still a bit early. These guys need to lock in. And one thing that is important to point out, despite the fact that Scribbles is a big part of this team that he is on, as he goes for a nice double, actually ended up dropping it down. I wonder if he's hoping to pass. He decided not to shoot. But Frosty and Reveal are great players. They're 16-year-old players. They're not under 15, and they are huge parts of this team. I think Reveal and Frosty both probably, you know, in discussions for MVP of the weekend, had they maybe, you know, been able to finish it out a little bit better. Obviously, at the end of the day, it's going to have to go to one of those top players on the top squads. But everybody on this team is solid, and those top players are willing to give Scribbles a chance. And Scribbles is about to just about outplay everybody in order to secure this game in Game 5. So this was actually in the 2-0 round of the Swiss. They were playing against Gen.G, who was also 2-0. And so the Snowmen went through the Swiss 3-0, no losses, followed it up with a win against Cloud9 in the quarters and made it to top four, where they actually rematched Gen.G. And while they looked decent, Gen.G did take it down in the best of seven. They were a little bit more prepared for a Snowmen team. They maybe didn't realize it was so good, because these guys are having, you know, the best performances we've seen from them. You know, in RLCS, they've been playing for a bit. They've been getting top results, but not quite as good as this one. And I think that's going to be the storyline for a lot of the young players, including the ones that we're going to go to next in our second replay coverage. For those of you who like to watch my streams, I think you guys knew that this was coming. Also, it was probably in the thumbnail, but Team Rock over in the Middle East is maybe the biggest example of what the rule change has enabled players to do. And that is a team that is full of players who would otherwise not be allowed to play. That's right. Unlike Snowmen, which has one player who is under 15 years old. What a launch by Nush. We are watching Nush POV right now. Everybody on Team Rock is 14 years old. So all of them would have had to wait another season at the very least to be able to play. And they have been taking MENA by storm. When they played in their first set of regionals, or set of qualifiers, I guess you'd call them, qualifier 1-3, they didn't even make top 16 at first, but every single time they have made it farther and farther, and they may as well be in the top four of MENA now. And who knows where it's going to end as they go to another regional coming up in a couple weeks. Make sure to check out not only the YouTube live streams, you can go check me out on Twitch as well if you guys want to see this team's runs. I've been covering them through the RLCS because they've been so exciting to watch, basically like a globetrotters of just regular Rocket League. I think MENA in general can just be really fun that way. But Nush, Dr. Known, and Ops. Nush is a guy that you guys have probably seen in my 1v1 show matches already, as he gets a double bump to allow Dr. Known to score first. But Dr. Known and Ops have played some great 3v3 as well, and they're worth covering. We'll switch to some of their POVs before the end of this, but Nush had a great start to this game. Which, by the way, what we're watching right now is also a top match against, or the players against a top team. Previously, we were watching Gen.G and Snowmen in the Swiss, but this is actually a quarterfinal matchup against Bravado, which before the mix-up in MENA, this team was tied for third. There was a clear number one, the Falcons, who got first every qualifier, and a clear number two in Rule 1, who got second every qualifier. And then there were two teams that would basically tie for third in points, and that was Twisted Minds and Bravado. Now, there's been a bunch of shakeup. Twisted Minds maybe look like they're an even better team. Rule 1 maybe fell off a little bit, but it was actually Rule 1 who took Venom away from Bravado and maybe downgraded this team a little bit. You would think that that would make sense, because they should be, you know, trying to pull, those top teams, I should say, should be trying to pull the best players that are available on lower teams. It shouldn't really be them downgrading. But that is not to downplay Team Rock's success against them, because I think that the reality is they have risen to a level that might have been, you know, taking down Bravado, even if they still had that same roster they had before with Venom. We're going to switch over to another POV while we're watching too, just to get a look at everybody. Dr. Known, if you guys don't know, the way Team Rock likes to play is pretty solid. I mean, they have a great coach, it would seem, and they have a great game plan. So you know, the top teams are playing a lot of kickoff games, or like a lot of kickoff type plays and styles. That is definitely the case here with Team Rock. They seem to have the kickoff advantage. In fact, a lot of different games almost seem to be won by their kickoff, because that ends up being the deciding factor in a one goal game, the fact that they've been able to sneak in some kickoff goals. But Dr. Known plays as their anchor, I would like to say. You know, there's a lot of teams that have some clear anchors. Of course, another one in the Middle East is Rawas, who, you know, maybe his team best player plays as the anchor. Another top team in the world, like KC, probably has Vatira back there as the anchor, as Ops is actually going to help Dr. Known out in making this save. But I do think that's how they use Dr. Known. Nush plays more like an Atto or a Nupo upfield, popping off, trying to go crazy. We saw him score the first few goals of this one, or at least set them up. I don't think Dr. Known got at least one of them, but Nush did the hard work for it. And so I think they have good rotation style. I think there are hiccups to clean up. And, you know, with each passing qualifier with reps against these top teams and, you know, chances to figure out what they need to improve, they seem to just be getting better and better. So hop on the hype train early. You know, I've been trying to show you guys the best players before they become mainstream, and certainly that's what Next Gen did in the past with the Kronik, Rawas, Daniels, and many other players who played in Next Gen, as Nush just barely misses high. But it seems like all signs are pointing to everybody that have been shown off in these replays as being next up, including Scribbles and this entire roster. Will we ever have them in a 1v1 tournament again and call it Next Gen? I don't know if we will. Maybe we'll get a show match between them. I know a lot of people were discussing, you know, they wanted to see a show match between the Snowmen and, oh, sorry, I switched off POVs when he got demoed, just matter of habit. Between the Snowmen and Rock, because Snowmen are average age 15 and a quarter, or 15 and a third, which is, you know, a super young team, and basically is not possible without having somebody under 15 years old nowadays. And this team is, of course, average age 14, so that's a huge save in and out of the net from Dr. Known, and then this play from Ops. I actually wanted to make sure we watch this one more time, because I think it highlights what Dr. Known does well, which is goal line defense, always keeping his squad in the game. And then Ops is actually a guy who probably gets the least coverage just because he doesn't play ones, but look at what he could do here. Faking off this ball, soft touch into the side flip power shot to secure this game with 30 seconds left to go. Ops is not like a third string player in here. He is definitely making stuff happen and has his games where he's their best player alongside all three of them, which is a good sign, because I think we've talked about it multiple times too. You can't really get away with having a carry nowadays. You do have to be well-rounded, and everybody on this Team Rock squad could be expected to improve. You know, nobody seems to be stuck, and everybody seems to be ready to hard grind and put in as much work as possible as Nush tries to make Ops' setup happen. Ops, probably in a different game context, tries to side flip that in, but, you know, up to, he doesn't need to try and milk out a goal. Ops is also playing with Dot as his name, but that is Ops, Nush, Dr. Known, and Scribbles. In the past, we would have had to wait to see just how good they could have been, but now the rule has changed. They can play, and they're starting to make top fours. If you guys like these videos, we're on the race to 100,000 subscribers before the end of the year. So if you can, hit the subscribe button. If not, I'll see you next time.